I've never been a big fan of Microsoft, or a little fan, or any kind of fan at all, really. But the first game console I ever bought was an Xbox 360. Why? Two words, Halo. Very funny. Thank you. I played the PC version and wanted to go on to the second game, but my laptop couldn't handle it. Also, Halo 3 had just come out and it was only available on the 360. So I got one. Then I discovered two more awards. Tom Clancy. When I realized I could play his games on this machine, I got really excited because, yes, I confess. My name is Irving, and I'm a Tom Clancy addict.
Hi, Irving.
I'll try almost anything with his name on it. So when I saw he'd made some games called Splinter Cell, I knew I had to check them out. Naturally, I was hooked. They've had a good run. Splinter Cell Conviction came out not that long ago. So let's take a look at this successful game series, starting at the beginning with Splinter Cell Stealth Action Redefined. So what exactly is a Splinter Cell? Well, it's a one-man operation based around stealth. How can one guy be a cell?
Kind of like me, the last living cell in a dead body.
He's the only one in the field, yes, but he's linked electronically to a whole team that gives him information, follows his every move, and helps him determine what to do next. His team is a branch of the NSA called Third Echelon, and their mandate revolves around what's known as the Fifth Freedom. This opening screen explains that. You have the right to freedom of speech, freedom of worship, from want, from fear. These rights wouldn't exist without a fifth one, the right to protect all other freedoms by whatever means necessary. That's where Third Echelon comes in, because Splinter Cell agent Sam Fisher is given a lot of latitude to exercise that fifth freedom. The game begins with a tutorial, basically Sam running a test course to be sure he's up to the task. As if there's any doubt, because if he wasn't, there'd be no game. But anyway. In the course of this introduction, we meet Sam and his old friend Irving Lambert. Hey, good name. They talk a little about what Third Echelon is for, then you meet the rest of the team. Junior Wilkes and Anna Grimm's daughter. Wilkes is your leg man. Grimm, as they call her, is the computer and electronics genius. But there's no time for pleasantries because a huge crisis is brewing. Of course! If there wasn't, the game would be these four people sitting around drinking coffee and wishing something would happen. Somehow, I don't think that'd sell very well. But that's just me. The characters are well fleshed out and three-dimensional, just like you'd expect from Tom Clancy. Michael Ironside is the voice of Sam Fisher, and of course he's terrific. His deep voice and soft but threatening tone make Sam as real as any character in a video game could be. Grimm likes to tease Sam about his age because she's basically a whiz kid. Junior is the wide-eyed boy who's fascinated by everything Sam does. Lambert is a little tainted by the politicians who control his actions, but so far he hasn't actually become one of them. Sam carries a silenced automatic pistol and later acquires some other weapons, but shooting is supposed to be a last resort. Stealth is the name of the game, and if you can sneak past the bad guys, do it. There's usually a way. The main thing you use Sam's gun for is shooting out lights. If you do have to shoot a bad guy, aim for his head. A single headshot is instantly fatal, but a kill usually requires at least three body shots. Of course, everybody from the president's bodyguards to the guy who scrubs toilets has a gun, so expect to take some damage of your own too. You have a health meter to tell you how you're doing, and you can find and carry a certain number of medical kits. One of the funnier aspects of the game is, when you use a med kit and some of Sam's health is restored, he does something like this. It sounds like somebody just stroked him in a very pleasant place. Come on, Sam, focus on the mission. You also have a light meter that tells you how exposed you are. The further to the right it goes, the more light is on you. All the way to the left and you're in total darkness. You have night vision goggles available so you can make your way around, and you'll use them a lot because darkness is just about your best friend. You can shoot enemies, of course, but most often you'll want to either slip past them or knock them out. To knock them out, you generally want to grab them first. Sneak up behind a guy until you get a prompt, then grab him. If he has information, you'll get a prompt to interrogate him. Once you're done with a guy, you just pull the right trigger and Sam will bop him over the head. Once he's down, you can pick up his body and carry him to an out-of-the-way place and deposit him so he's not discovered. Hiding bodies is a big deal in these games because a discovered body will trigger an alarm. Some missions are alarm sensitive, X number of alarms and the mission is over, which means you failed and have to start again from the last checkpoint. If you can't find a way to get behind a guy, you can just run up and punch him. Now, here's our first bit of weirdness. If he's a civilian, he'll crumple like a tower of jello as soon as you hit him. But if he's got a gun of any kind, it'll take 2 hits to put him down. In between the 2 hits, he'll shoot you at least 3 times. I don't know why the discrepancy, but it does get frustrating sometimes. You get most of your information from computers. When you get a prompt to use a computer, take it. Sam has an opsat, which is basically a PDA with a satellite uplink where he stores information. Use a computer and you'll usually get a data stick from it. Most of the messages on these data sticks take the form of emails, but they often include useful information like door codes, locations of important items, and people to check out. If you don't find the right data stick with the door code on it, don't expect to get through certain doors because you won't be able to. Well, you can look it up on GameFAQs, but that would be cheating. The bulk of the story revolves around Georgia. Georgia the country, hello! When the Soviet Union fell, it left a lot of power vacuums in its various republics. Naturally, humans being what they are, there were plenty of egotistical jerks waiting to fill those vacuums. In this case, one of those jerks was Combain Nicolaides. When he didn't get power, he bided his time, built up a base of support, had the current president assassinated, and took over. Now he's rattling his saber at the United States, and some reports coming out of the CIA suggest that he has some means of making good on his threats. Your job is to find out what he has, what he plans to do with it, and, of course, stop him. First step, find a couple of missing CIA agents. One of them worked undercover in Nicolaides' administration for 2 years, then suddenly went off the grid. A second agent was sent in to find her. A few days later, he also vanished. Is this somebody's opinion of the CIA's efficiency? I'm not asking. Both were carrying subdermal transponders, so you have to find the receiver tuned to them and hopefully figure out what's going on. You make your way around an area of Tbilisi, the capital of Georgia, trying to meet an agency contact who will tell you what to do next. You have to find ways past Nicolaides' goons, of which he seems to have about a zillion. When you find your contact, he's dying inside a burning building. He tells you where to find the receiver and dies. So now you have to find the CIA agent's apartment and check the receiver. There are bad guys there, of course, and you'll have to knock out at least one of them. You find the receiver, which is actually a computer, and discover that both agents' transponders are offline. On to the local police station to confirm that they're dead. Yep, you're infiltrating a police station. You go in through the back door late at night when the drunks in the cells are supposed to be asleep. They may or may not be.
Is there anybody else seeing a bionic commando?
I think I've got the big fish.
I'll mind my own business.
But they don't raise any fuss. Basically, they're just there for comic relief. You work your way to the morgue and find the bodies. You also find that there's a surveillance camera in the room. The locals realize how silly that is. One of the data sticks you can pick up is an email from a supervisor telling someone else that there should be a better place for that camera since he's never seen a corpse commit a crime. The camera gives you the idea to check out the security tapes to see who killed the agents. On the way, you can hear this exchange.
I'd like to talk to your superior.
Perhaps I can help you, sir.
By fetching your superior.
I'm all there is. How can I help you?
I'd like to register a complaint.
Then you'll have to ask at the desk to your right.
Very well.
May I help you?
You're the same cop.
Yes, but this is the public relations desk.
Fine. I would like to register a complaint.
Of course, sir. If you could just have a seat until somebody's ready to help you.
You've got to be kidding me.
I could easily have you arrested, sir.
Isn't it nice to know bureaucracy's the same in any language? Upstairs to the security office where you get the info.
Great work, Fisher. We're scanning the videotapes now.
There. That's our guy. We got him red-handed.
Can you run his face through echelon?
Already on it. Hey, check it out. A license plate. 84KP214.
Wait a minute. His car was in the morgue? Oh, no. She was checking out tapes from other cameras, too. I guess. Things are really telescoped there, but just go with it. So you're off to the Defense Ministry to find this guy. His name is Vyacheslav Grinko, and you'll find him by his license plate. If he's not with his car, his driver will be, and you can make him tell you where to find Grinko.
Don't be afraid to use force.
Who? Me?
The driver tells you Grinko is meeting with a guy named Philip Mass. Mass is a computer geek with no conscience. As you deal with him, you learn that he's a fairly typical prodigy. He thinks he's above everybody else. Grim uploads some info on him to your OPSAT, and among other things, you learn he's been working for Nikolods for a few years now, and all he seems to care about is the money he's getting. Lambert changes the mission. He wants to hear the conversation between Grinko and Mass. So now you have to make your way to the courtyard of the ministry, shut off a laser grid protecting it, and use your laser microphone to record their conversation. They're having it in a glass elevator, so your laser mic can pick it up.
Isn't that convenient?
The glass elevator's in motion.
Make with the laser, Mike Fisher. It's mission critical that we hear what Grinko and Mass say before they reach the top.
I can do it a lot faster if you guys will shut up.
Savages. Why did you rip it out with pliers?
We had some difficulty with Blofield's chip. You can see fibers of muscle tissue still attached.
Nasty. Nasty.
You're in the wrong line of work to avoid getting gore on your hands.
Whatever Nikolaj does in Azerbaijan is his own conscience's burden.
You are just a tool?
You're a tool. I'm the technology. I'm the cleanup man. All the blood's on yours and Nikolaj's hands. I'm clean.
And it is?
It's what?
Clean.
Azerbaijan? Yeah, man. The operation's goddamn immaculate. Except for the files. Nikolaj insists on keeping on his own machine. You need to talk to that.
Did you get that? Nikolaj is keeping some files about his activities in Azerbaijan on the computer in his office. Guess what you need to do next? If you access all the computers in this part of the level, you'll see the first mention of something codenamed the Ark. We don't know what it is yet, but it sounds ominous. When you get the info off Nikolaj's computer, Lambert has a cow. Somehow, Nikolaj has been systematically exterminating the Azerbaijanis and taking over the country so he can control their oil. The atrocities are too many to name, and America is going to war. Meanwhile, somebody has detected unauthorized access to Nikolaj's computer, and you have to make yourself scarce. It took me several times to figure out how to do this, because you have to run outside, find an open elevator shaft, and then do this.
I want an update. Why hasn't the intruder been caught yet? Do we have men on the rear stairwell?
About to breach the stairwell, sir.
The game almost lost me with that one, because let's face it, even an agent in top physical condition and with the reflexes of the Flash probably couldn't pull this off. But it's a game, not reality. So again, just go with it. For reasons that are never really explained, you now find yourself on an oil rig in the Caspian Sea near Georgia. One of Nikolaj's computer geeks is on his way here to gather some information, and you're to intercept him. Sam asks why this particular oil rig, and nobody really knows. And that question never comes up again. Oh, by the way, Mr. Super Duper Secret Agent can't swim. You have some minor enemies and some major ones in this level. The minor ones are the Georgian guards, of course. The major ones are American warplanes firing missiles to reduce the place to its component atoms. Obviously, they don't know you're there. At least you hope not. So you get to dodge both enemy bullets and friendly explosions while you try to catch up with this programmer, who by now has downloaded whatever info he was after to a laptop in his briefcase. This level is about as stealthy as a charging rhinoceros. With everything that's going on, all you can do is shoot your way through the bad guys and try to keep up with the programmer. When you do catch up with him, he tells you the info he was sent to retrieve is something about an Ark. That's all he knows, so that's the end of the mission. Back on your Osprey aircraft with Wilkes and Grimm, Wilkes is trying to patch a phone call through to Sam's daughter, Sarah. This is the first mention of Sarah, and until we get to conviction, she's not especially important. But knowing Sam has a daughter and that he's trying to stay in touch with her tells you more about the guy, so she serves a purpose. Their call is cut off when things go crazy on the plane. Once you're back under control, Lambert comes on the line and tells you Nicolaus has declared war on the United States. He's launched a massive cyber attack on the country, hitting communications, travel, military installations, you name it. Although Nicolaus himself is now in hiding, he uses the internet to claim responsibility for the attacks and assure the U.S. that this is only the beginning. Meanwhile, Grimm is still working on that laptop you recovered from the oil rig. She discovers that the only way Nicolaus could have most of the information he has is if there's a mole in the CIA working for him. So now you have to infiltrate CIA headquarters in Virginia and track down who the mole is. Here's what I don't get. With this kind of hard info in hand, why can't the NSA people just talk to the CIA people and tell them, hey, you've got a mole inside your headquarters? Instead of taking the sensible route, Sam has to make his way into the CIA's main building, slip past everybody without a single fatality, and get to their main server so Grimm can sort out who's feeding information to Nicolaus. I don't get it. And really, this is probably my least favorite level in the game, simply because you're on such a tight leash. The only good thing about this level is, it finally introduces you to Sam's most useful weapon, the SC-20K rifle. Up until now, you've been limited to a pistol that's about as accurate as pissing in a hurricane, so the rifle is a major improvement. It can fire 5.56mm standard NATO bullets, but it also has a launcher that can fire non-lethal rounds. The non-lethal ammo has some problems, though. First, there's precious little of it. Your two most useful, supposedly, kinds are the ring airfoil round and the sticky shocker. The ring airfoil is a little metal ring that your rifle fires at subsonic speed. If you can hit your target in the head, it's supposed to knock him out instantly. Hit him anywhere else, and he'll stand there going like this for a few seconds, hopefully giving you time to run up and punch him and finish the job. The sticky shocker is pretty cool. Hit a guy anywhere and it makes him go like this and knocks him unconscious.
Ahem.
I think I can guess what this is about.
Presumptuous, aren't we? Have you examined the photos of this ring airfoil device?
Yes, I've looked at the photos. What about it?
It's utterly impossible, you know. A ring-shaped projectile has no aerodynamic quality at all, so if such a device were ever actually used, it would tumble in various random directions and never hit any kind of target. Furthermore, what kind of propulsion is used with such a device? What sort of mechanism can accelerate such an object to subsonic speeds? How is it...
I don't know about the ring airfoil round, but obviously the sticky shocker works just fine. I rather enjoyed that. If you're really lucky, your ammo loadout gives you three or four of each. That's not much when you're dealing with dozens of bad guys, so you have to use it sparingly. Another sort of handy gadget in your non-lethal bag of tricks is the remote camera. This is a camera that you can shoot and have it stick to just about anything. It transmits real-time video back to your OPSAT so you can see what the bad guys are doing. There are two types. The sticky camera just sends you video, but it has night vision and thermal capability, so it's useful in a variety of situations. The diversion camera can't do night or thermal vision, but it can make a noise that'll draw the bad guy's attention. Then when they're close enough, you can make it spray knockout gas and incapacitate them. Unfortunately, you don't get these very often, and there's no way to change your loadout. You take what the program gives you and be happy with it. So in the CIA headquarters, you get a couple of sticky shockers and less than a handful of ring airfoil rounds, and that's all you're allowed to use. Thanks a bunch. Oh yeah, since the ring airfoil round is basically just a hard projectile, you'd think you'd be able to pick it up and use it again. No such luck. The other problem with the non-lethal ammo is that your sight is horribly inaccurate. I've been less than 10 feet away from somebody, lined up right on his head and fired a ring airfoil round and missed. Again, thanks a bunch. This is supposed to be an advanced, state-of-the-art weapon, and if you're more than 2 steps away, the non-lethal stuff may or may not hit what you're aiming at. It must be related to the pistol. Of course, the CIA guys are under no restrictions about shooting you, so expect to die a lot before you get done. This level is a pain in the butt. Eventually, you get to the server and find that the mole is a low-level guy named Doherty. You kidnap him and smuggle him out of the most heavily guarded agency building probably in the entire world. Turns out that Nikolodz's people managed to tap this guy's computer, and when Grimm finds that out, they discover her and shut it down. She figures out, however, that the signal is going to a building nearby owned by a company called Kalinatech. That's your next assignment. I'm not going to go into detail on the CIA mission because it's too annoying even to talk about. Get through the game once, and then the next time you play the game, skip it altogether. That's what I started doing, and it's probably one reason why I still have most of my hair. That wraps up part one of this review. Come back next week and we'll check out the rest of the game, starting with Kalinatech and finishing up God only knows where, because Sam does get around. Until then, I'm Irving, and I have no life, just like you.
He was short and fat and rode out of the west with a Mogan David on his silver vest. He was mean and nasty right clear through, which was kind of weird because he was yellow too. They called him Irving. Big Irving. Big Short Irving. Big Short Fat Irving. The 142nd fastest gun in the west. Irving.